Welcome to this short tutorial. Heinz Walz GmbH builds a range of instruments for fluorescence measurements. To make optimal use of these instruments, a basic understanding of chlorophyll fluorescence and its measurement is needed. This basic knowledge we want to address in this tutorial. For more detailed questions that you may still have after watching the presentation, the manual of the instrument you work with can be a good source of information as well. In this short tutorial, we will discuss the relevant considerations and choices you, as experimenter, must reflect on and make to get meaningful fluorescence data with the MINI-PAM-II. After a short introduction, the following topics will be discussed. Different aspects related to measuring light and F0, saturation pulses and FM, choice of dark acclimation times, choice of actinic light intensities, and finally rapid light curves and pre-illumination. By clicking in the timeline, it is possible to select a topic of interest. But first, the relationship between photosynthesis and chlorophyll fluorescence. Sunlight is a driving force of photosynthesis. Absorbed sunlight is either used for photochemistry or it is re-emitted as fluorescence or heat. Photochemical energy in the form of ATP and NADPH, together with CO2, drive the synthesis of sugars that are subsequently exported out of the leaf. At the beginning of this process, oxygen is formed and released in the air. Finally, the flow of water from the roots to the leaf is important to keep photosynthesis going. This figure illustrates that chlorophyll fluorescence is only one of many fluxes related to leaf photosynthesis. With fluorescence measurements, we mainly probe the effects of photosynthesis as sensed by photosynthesis. This is the reaction center at the beginning of the photosynthetic electron transport chain, the reaction center that can split water in oxygen, protons and electrons. One of the central functions of reaction centers is the creation of a stable charge separation. Light energy drives the transfer of an electron from one side of the protein to the other, from one side of the membrane to the other. If this process can take place in all reaction centers, we say all reaction centers are open. The fluorescence emission is minimal, F0. If this process cannot take place at all, we say all reaction centers are closed and the fluorescence emission is maximal, FM. It is important to realize that fluorescence is inversely related to photosynthesis. More fluorescence means less photosynthesis. Before the introduction of pulse amplitude modulation or PAM instruments, it was for technical reasons impossible to determine F0 and FM correctly in a single experiment. The pulse amplitude modulation or PAM method solved this problem by separating the effect of modulated measuring light, where LEDs give short pulse of light at a certain frequency, and continuous actinic light, which drives photosynthesis. PAM instruments are blind to fluorescence induced by continuous light, even very intense continuous light. It only sees fluorescence induced by modulated light. There are several abbreviations that will regularly show up in this tutorial and will be explained here. ML is measuring light, low intensity modulated light that has little or no effect on the redox state of photosynthesis. SP is saturation pulse, strong pulse of light that closes all open reaction centers in a short period of time. AL, actinic light, perceived by the detector as continuous light and used by the instrument to drive photosynthesis. Light is actinic if it induces a measurable accumulation of the photosynthesis reaction factor, QA-. The next slide illustrates the PAM principle. The abbreviation PAM stands for pulse amplitude modulated. This means in practice that the instrument will only measure fluorescence induced by modulated light. This modulated light is therefore called measuring light. Light applied to a photosynthetic sample induces fluorescence. Modulated light induces modulated fluorescence. The instrument measures each time the difference between the fluorescence value at the beginning of the modulated pulse and at its peak. As long as the pump fluorescence intensity does not change, the photosynthetic state of the sample does not change. The photosynthetic state can be changed by application of continuous light. The instrument will not see this continuous light directly. It will detect the consequences of this continuous actinic light. More reduced QA will increase the amplitude of the modulated fluorescence and thereby the pump fluorescence intensity. Until now, the dark state, which is defined by F0 and Fm, has been discussed. Illumination of a sample with actinic light changes the fluorescence properties of a photosynthetic sample. In most cases, illumination leads to lower F0 and Fm values. F0 and Fm values determine in the light. We call F0 dash and Fm dash. The fluorescence intensity induced by the actinic light is called F. In the next slide, this is illustrated by a measurement of a Kautsky induction curve. First, a saturation pulse is given to determine the reference F0 and Fm. This is followed by a 200 seconds illumination with actinic light to induce the steady state. The illumination is finished by another saturation pulse to determine the light acclimated fluorescence values F, Fm dash and F0 dash. The measurement illustrates that the light acclimated Fm dash and F0 dash values are considerably smaller than the reference Fm and F0 value. If a sufficient time of darkness is allowed, both Fm dash and F0 dash will relax back to the reference F0 and Fm values. If we look at the second saturation pulse more closely, the Fm dash minus F values give information about the fraction of photosym2 reaction centers that were still open. We call this photochemical quenching. The difference between the reference Fm and Fm dash gives information about so-called non-photochemical quenching. Putting this in words, thanks to the accurate determination of F0 and Fm, the saturation pulse could be introduced as a diagnostic tool. At Fm or Fm dash, all photosym2 reaction centers are closed and photochemistry is by definition zero. This level defines the point at which photochemical quenching is zero. As illustrated by the induction experiment, in the light the Fm value decreases. The main reason for this decrease is that the rate constant for heat emission increases and more heat means less fluorescence. The processes that cause a decrease of Fm are collectively called non-photochemical quenching. Depending on the formula used for the calculation of non-photochemical quenching, the terms Qn and MPQ are used. If a sample is thoroughly dark acclimated, non-photochemical quenching is by definition zero, and the measured Fm is the reference F. In summary, PAM instruments can accurately determine F0 and Fm using a combination of modulated measuring light and a strong pulse of continuous light. These saturation pulses can be used to determine accurately photochemical quenching related to the closure of still open reaction centers and non-photochemical quenching related to processes that lower the Fm value. After this short introduction, we will now switch to the main topic of this presentation, technical aspects of fluorescence measurements. We will start with measuring light and F0. Discussing the modulated measuring light, two parameters have to be considered, the pulse intensity and the pulse frequency. If the pulse intensity is increased, the signal noise will decrease. If the pulse frequency is increased, the time resolution of the measurement is increased. Playing with pulse intensity and pulse frequency, it is possible to control the integrated light intensity. To the user of the MINI-PAM-II, 12 measuring light intensities are available. In the wind control software, it is further possible to choose between 1 to 5 Hz for the FCO determinations. That is 1 pulse per second, down to 1 pulse per 200 milliseconds. The signal intensity can also be increased by the gain. This will increase both signal amplitude and noise. It has no effect on the integrated light intensity. For the determination of F0, the frequency can be low. The main consideration is that it should not be actinic. Time resolution plays no role. A considerably higher frequency is needed to record the fluorescence induced by a saturation pulse accurately. The instrument switches automatically to a 100 Hz frequency at actinic light intensities higher than level 3. A frequency of 100 Hz can resolve fluorescence changes with a time resolution of 10 milliseconds. It is not important that high frequency measuring light actinic. The instrument will correct for this by adding the integrated measuring light intensity to the actinic light intensity. There is another consideration. The FM value is approximately 5 to 6 times the F0 value in leaves, and the scale is a bit more than 4,000 units. This means that the combination of measuring light intensity and gain should give an F0 value that does not exceed 600 to 700 units to keep the FM on scale. To draw the attention of the user to off-scale FM values, several things happen. At the instrument level, the screen of the instrument gives a warning. When the instrument is connected to a computer and the wind control software is used, a warning shows up at the bottom of the software window. In the SatChart window, the pulse panel turns red, and finally the software refuses to calculate the quantum yield of Photosynthesis 2. The solution for this problem is simple. By reducing the measuring light intensity and or the gain, the saturation pulses can be brought on scale again. When only internal light sources are used, the experimenter can determine F0- values in two different ways. Use F0- mode or not. If F0- mode is unchecked, the software will calculate F0-. If F0- mode is checked, a farad pulse will follow each saturation pulse and the F0- value is experimentally determined. The panel on the right-hand side illustrates what that looks like. The farad pulses may perturb the measurement somewhat. Whereas the calculation is not 100% accurate, the choice is yours. After F0, we will discuss saturation pulses and FM. Saturation pulses are the most important diagnostic tool used in palm fluorimetry. A good saturation pulse fulfills several criteria. A saturating pulse should be strong enough and long enough to close all Photosynthesis 2 reaction centers, that is to reach FM or FM- respectively. It should, however, not be longer than necessary to avoid the induction of non-photochemical quenching. A fourth criterion is that a saturation pulse should not affect the next saturation pulse. That means that the pulse interval should be sufficiently long. In the light, the interval can be relatively short. In darkness, on the other hand, considerably longer time intervals are needed. As the four panels show, 200 milliseconds is too short. No plateau is reached, and the software places the FM line underneath the measured maximum. 1 and 1.5 seconds, on the other hand, are too long. The optimal pulse interval length is species dependent. As indicated in the slide, in the settings window of wind control, the saturation pulse intensity and length can be adjusted with 200 milliseconds as the minimum pulse length. What does this mean for the MINI-PAM-II saturation pulse? The maximum saturation pulse intensity of 6,000 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second should be chosen. A saturation pulse length of 300 to 500 milliseconds is in most cases enough. The default pulse interval in the light for induction experiments is 20 seconds, but longer is also okay. And during subsequent dark recovery, increasing pulse intervals are used. This is also the place to mention the difference between the F0 FM button and the SAT button. The F0 FM button is used for the determination of the reference F0 and FM values, whereas the SAT button is used for the determination of FM dash values. I earlier dropped the term thoroughly dark acclimated. What can be considered a good dark acclimation time? It is not possible to give a simple answer to this question. It depends on the state of the sample at the start of the dark acclimation period, and as well on the state of the experimenter wants to measure. Situation 1. Let's assume we apply a single saturation pulse to a thoroughly dark acclimated angiosperm leaf. A saturation pulse reduces the whole electron transport chain from photosystem 2 to the acceptor site of photosystem 1. In this case, it is better to use the term dark adaptation for the reoxidation of the electron transport chain back to the initial dark state. This process is mainly determined by the reoxidation of the plastic nonpole in darkness, which takes only a few seconds in grasses and sedges, and can take more than 10 minutes, 4 times the half-time, in certain other species. The regeneration of the dark state of the oxygen-evolving complex takes about 2 minutes. In most cases, 5 to 10 minutes of dark time is enough. Situation 2. What if we would expose a leaf for 5 to 10 minutes to 50 to 100 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second? This light intensity is high enough to activate the acceptor site of photosystem 1 and the Calvin-Benson cycle. It is in most cases not high enough to induce regulatory processes like the Xanthophyll cycle, and certainly not high enough to induce high levels of photon inhibition in activation of photosystem 2. Dark acclimation in this case requires inactivation of the acceptor site of photosystem 1 and the Calvin-Benson cycle as well. In pea leaves, inactivation of the photosystem 1 acceptor site takes about 15 minutes. Situation 3. What if we illuminate a leaf with high light intensities for prolonged times? This will induce a Xanthophyll cycle, which facilitates higher rates of heat dissipation and lower fluorescence values, and photoinhibition. Photoinhibited photosystem 2 reaction cells lose their variable fluorescence. In this case, it will take hours to reverse the Xanthophyll cycle and repair the damaged photosystem 2 reaction centers. For measurements carried out in the field, pre-dawn measurements can give the experimenter reference F0 and FM values for measurements during the day. The final topic treated is the actinic light range. Here we would suggest the experimenter to consider the Grove light intensity. Actinic light intensities ranging from 0 to 4 times the Grove light intensity could be a good range. For shade plants, the suggested range would be 0 to 100 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second. For green algae that are often cultured at 50 to 200 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second, the suggested range would be 0 to 800 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second. And for sunflowers grown in the field, acclimated to high light intensities, the suggested range would be all light intensities available. Rapid light curves represent a somewhat different challenge. For this type of experiment, light steps of maybe 10 or 20 seconds are used. At the same time, the activation of the Calvin-Benson cycle takes 2 to 3 minutes. If a rapid light curve experiment would be carried out with a dark acclimated leaf, experimental artifacts are almost unavoidable. For the MINI-PAM-II, the following protocol is suggested in case dark acclimated leaves are used. The saturation pulse that is given at the beginning of a light curve should be turned off by unchecking with initial pulse. Determine the reference F0 and FM by clicking the F0 FM button. Give manual a 2 to 3 minute pre-illumination of, for example, 50 micromoles of photons per square meter and per second. And finally, start the light curve. With this, I will end this short tutorial. Thank you for your attention.